do we re-envision a future of healthcare?
People are on self-help. That is, they manufacture their own diseases. I would like to see a day when doctors, before they touch another patient, first fix themselves internally. We evolved a simple device called Jeevarasa. You will see miraculous things happening to people. There are specific scientific ways of doing that. 60-70% of them will just come out of their problems, just being in touch with this.
I do want to say a disclaimer. One of my friends said to me once, you know how, like, it's never a disease? Somebody recognizes the disease until the white male gets it. So what I want to say about many of what we're talking about in terms of a more holistic approach to healthcare is the foundation of many health professions in this country. Nursing, many health professions are based in those beliefs, but it's not the dominant paradigm. So the dominant medical paradigm is we have a disease that we have to fight. And it's revealed in the language that we use, you know, antibiotics, antipsychotics, anti. The concept that disease sits over there and the job of medicine is to fight that battle and win.
So this whole concept and this approach to modern medicine has come because you need to understand when they thought of medicine, when they thought of developing some kind of medicine and a system of medical treatment, their problem was only with infectious diseases and contagious diseases. How to treat the plague, how to treat the smallpox, how to treat this. Nobody ever thought of a diabetes or a hypertension or a cardiac problem. They never even considered those things that did not exist in their radar. In their radar, only infectious diseases did exist. That has to be handled on a war footing, no question about that. Because it is a war. An infection means it's an invasion from another organism upon our own system, and you have to use chemical weapons. You can't shoot them. So, this whole medical system evolved from the need to handle infectious diseases, contagious diseases which were taking a huge toll on populations in those times. But today we have come to a place where people are on self-help. That is, they manufacture their own diseases. They don't wait for any infection to happen to them. Because now they're on self-help, they need another system of medicine, another way to approach it completely, which is the shift we are struggling to make right now.
Well, and if I may, I looked at Dr. Schneiderman because Ralph does a wonderful job of giving kind of the scientific history of the medical paradigm. And as you were saying, I won't do this nearly as well as you will, Dr. Schneiderman, but that, you know, in the late 1800s, germ theory, right? So our find it, fix it approach of the medical
mainly infectious diseases, that was their concern.
And I'm making gross generalizations, but the dominant medical model is still designed, our core competency is still designed on the find it, fix it approach, which is clearly failing. In Western medicine, we're taught to diagnose and treat the diseases of the body, the diseases of the mind. But we have missed that the doorway to the health and healing of the body and mind is really, in my opinion, the heart and the soul. So how do we re-envision a future of healthcare where there aren't those boundaries?
See, the ideal is one thing, and what we can do today is a different thing, okay? The ideal would be that we look at human well-being, not human health. If you consider human well-being as a composite subject and an approach, then you would consider what makes a human being complete and approach all of them together. That is the best way to do it. But today, what can we do, if that's a question? We can only talk about, somewhere having a little… We can't marry them yet. We can only have a date.
I kind of like to jump right in.
The situation is not ready to simply get them together, no. Because a lot more work has to be done. It's not going to happen in a short span of time. But we can start interfacing here and there. It is possible that hospitals can have a meditation center going within them. And it is possible meditation centers already generally have, but we can make sure that there's a little bit of health center out there. We can start having a little bit of a skirmish right now. Right now they're not ready for total union, because in both the sides, there are too many opinions about each other. Largely, people are not looking at the whole health as such. They are trying to impart what they have studied or what they have grasped. It doesn't matter whether it addresses the whole humanity or the whole human being or not. So that attitudinal change is not going to happen just like that. Till a day comes when medical education includes all these things, which may make it even longer than the way it is right now. And I would like to see a day when doctors, before they touch another patient, first fix themselves internally before they touch somebody else, because this is all important. When I say this is all important, today sufficient research has gone into, particularly into water, scientific research. And what these scientists are saying is, water has memory. If you give it a thought, it remembers. If you give it an emotion, it remembers. If you give it a touch, it remembers. So, if elements have that kind of memory outside, you can change the quality of water just by touching it or with a thought or an emotion or a hand. The beautiful experiment conducted by a 12-year-old girl and a 10-year-old boy in India. What they did was, they read about this somewhere on the internet and they came home and they set up two glass pots of water. One room, same water in two glass pots. One room they go and express very loving emotions, they touch it, they kiss it, they hug it every day for 10 minutes. Another room they go and abuse it and do express all kinds of negativity. Their mother was very concerned, "I can't believe they have so much negative emotion in them." They're expressing it to the water. In 10 days' time, this water for which they were abusing and expressing negative emotion, it turned dark. The other water remained just like that. They posted it on the YouTube, you must see it. So this is something we have always known. In India, in part of our life, nobody in traditional Indian home ever drinks water from a tap. It doesn't matter whether it's potable or not potable. Even if it is say, if it said potable, it is not. What we do is we take a copper vessel or a... See, here they put a... Otherwise, always next to me there's a copper vessel or a brass vessel, and they will take it, they'll wash it with turmeric and tamarind and everything in the night, put water in it, they will apply something, what is considered sacred symbols on it, they worship this, and then only tomorrow morning it is given to your family. Because water has memory. They're saying if the water is pumped through the pipe, and it's taking 50 bends by the time it comes to your house, by the time it comes to your house, 60% of it, the molecular change in it is such that it is literally turned into poison. But if you take it in your glass and hold it for about 20 minutes, it will undo itself. But just the forceful pumping, not contamination, just the forceful pumping is making the water in molecular structure in such a way that it's harmful to human health. So if you're doing that to the water, if you're treating this with all kinds of emotions and negativities and, you know, all kinds of abuse to yourself and to others, the water here also behaves the same way. So in India, we have a word called teerth. Teerth means consecrated water. You can consecrate the water in such a way. There are simple ways to do it. We evolved a simple device called jivarasam. Jivarasam means the juice of life. This is the juice of life, is water. And if you treat the water with this jivarasam and then drink it, you will see miraculous things happening to people. This is not new. Always every human being who lived on this planet with a certain connection with nature around him always knew this. So one of the things that we can do, particularly for people who are going to war and coming back, whatever. War is the most extreme situation that human beings can create by themselves. For other things, you need nature's help, you know. People who have been put through this ringer, if they're coming in broken states, one of the best things you could do is all of them compulsorily should go through at least 1 month of living on a farm, being connected to the soil and water and air around them, putting their bare hands into the land and doing something simple, just being connected. I must tell you this experience. We had a yogic hospital in our yoga center in India. We called it yogic hospital. We did not want it to grow too much because we don't want to turn into a hospital full time. We are a spiritual center. So we're keeping it low key. Once when I came here, I spoke and a few doctors, American doctors who were interested, they traveled to India. They came and stayed there for 3 days and after 3 days, one of the volunteers came and told me all the American doctors are up in arms, they want to leave. I said, what happened? They said, it's best that you meet them, they're just off. Then I said, okay, and I went to meet them. Then I said, what's the problem? They said, you said there is a hospital. Where is a hospital? There is no hospital here. I said, right now there are about 60 and odd patients. But where is it? Their idea of a hospital is that there must be beds, you must treat sick well, and everybody should be… If you treat them so well, they will not want to become healthy. Where are the patients? I said, they're all in the garden, I put them to work. We give them the treatment and therapies and medication, but rest of the time I put them to work. Whatever they can do, they must do. Above all, they must sit and work barefoot and bare hands with the soil. Just being in touch with the planet, because you're just a drop of this planet, you're forgetting that. What you call as my body is just a piece of the planet, isn't it? If you lose connection with the source, will you not get disorganized? There are specific scientific ways of doing that. If you cannot do any of those things, at least just let them walk in a farm barefoot, work, do something, you will see at least 60-70% of them will just come out of their problems, just like that, just being in touch with.